The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Hello, this is The English We Speak. With me, Feifei, and joining me is Rob. Hello, Rob.
Hello. Now, I was thinking, you always start the programme. It's never me.
That's right. I have always started the programme. That's the way I like it.
Really? And you always introduce the examples.
I do, Rob. It's just the way I like to do it, and I know what's best.
Hmm. You mean you do you?
I do me?
No, you do you. It means you do your own thing. You know your own mind, and you probably won't change.
You do you. Hmm, yes. Thanks for clearing that up, Rob. I guess you're right.
Hmm, thanks. But can I introduce the examples today, please?
No.
Look, we can't agree on this. You do you, and we'll talk about this again later. I told my girlfriend to do more exercise, but she wouldn't listen. So I told her, you do you, I'm off for a run. I like the way you do you. You stick to what you think is right and are not influenced by other people's comments.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learner English, and we're talking about the expression you do you, which can be said to someone to mean they always behave in the same way and they won't change. Of course, Rob, I couldn't do things your way.
Oh, why?
You're always late, so it's best if I start the programme. And there's another reason why I always do me. I'm always right.
Oh, in that case, maybe I can do you too.
It's okay, Rob. It's best if you do you and I'll do me.
Who, me? Oh, this is very confusing.
I'll tell you what you can do. You can finish the programme because I've got to go. Bye.
Right, that's all for this, The English We Speak. Bye. Feifei, where have you gone?
The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Neil.
And I'm Feifei.
You're a pretty polite person, aren't you, Feifei?
Oh, well, thanks. I don't know, I try to be.
Well, that was a very polite answer. But sometimes we want to say things that are very honest or that others might not want to hear.
For example, I ask you, do I look tired today?
Well, I could directly say, yes, you do look a bit tired.
Or you could start with this slang expression, not gonna lie.
Not gonna lie, Feifei, you do look a little tired.
I know, I need to get to bed earlier. Gonna, of course, is short for going to. Using this phrase indicates that you're choosing to be honest rather than polite.
It's not only used for honest criticism, we might also use it before something we're very proud of or something we boast about. For example, I love recording these programmes, though I'm not gonna lie, I'm the best presenter in this team.
Well, that's enough. I'm sure everyone listening agrees that I am the best presenter.
Of course, you're a fantastic presenter, Feifei. Just an example.
Talking of examples, let's hear a few more.
Fancy coming round for dinner tomorrow?
Absolutely. If you're making your famous roast.
Oh, yes. Not gonna lie, it's the best roast in town.
Slow down. You really are a terrible driver, Mark. Not gonna lie.
Not gonna lie, I absolutely love my job. I feel so happy when I walk through the office door every day.
That last example sounds just like me, especially as I'm the best presenter.
Okay, okay. That joke is getting old now.
You're right. Okay, one more thing. This phrase, not gonna lie.
Yes.
Not gonna lie, I think some people use it too much.
Yes, it's become a popular phrase on social media, usually accompanied by a photo of someone on holiday at the beach with a post saying, not gonna lie, it's stunning here.
The kind of post that makes me feel jealous when I'm stuck in the office.
But I thought you loved your job.
Oh, I do.
And yes, you are a very good presenter, Neil.
That makes me feel much better, not gonna lie.
Bye.
Goodbye.
The English We Speak
from BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. With me, Feifei.
And me, Roy.
We may sound a little different. That's because we're not able to record in our normal studios during the coronavirus outbreak. In this program, we have a phrase that means to keep talking about something, usually in a boring or annoying way. You kept talking about some band this morning. What were you banging on about?
What do you mean banging on? I wasn't hitting anything this morning with a pan. I was just talking about music with Neil.
Exactly. You were talking about it so much, and I was trying to work. Banging on about something isn't literal. And why would you mention a pan? It means you were talking about something to a level that it became annoying.
Ah, the way in which you kept talking about that film, Unicorns Eat Bananas in the Stars. You banged on about it so much last week that people left the room.
That film is amazing.
Feifei, you kept giving people spoilers and nobody went to see the film in the end because you kept banging on about everything that happened.
Well, that's your opinion, Roy. Anyway, let's listen to these examples.
My friend keeps banging on about where he's going to go when he buys his new car. It's really frustrating. That person on the bus was really annoying. She kept banging on about how the prices had gone up. Will you please stop banging on about my project? If you think you could do a better job, you can do my work for me.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression bang on about something, which is used to say that someone is talking about something so much that it is annoying or irritating.
Sorry, Feifei. I didn't mean to say you were banging on about that film. Everyone did love your enthusiasm about it.
I'm sorry too, Roy. I just wanted to know more about the band you were talking about, so I found it annoying that I didn't understand.
Oh, well, next I'll tell you more about it.
That's okay. I think I've heard enough about your taste in music for one lifetime. But thanks anyway. Bye, Roy.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. With me, Feifei.
And me, Roy.
In this programme, we have an expression which describes when someone has read the message you've sent them but hasn't replied. That reminds me, Roy, did you get my message yesterday?
Yes, I did. I read it and then totally forgot to answer you. Was it something important?
I can't believe it. You completely ignored my message. I got left on red.
What's the colour red got to do with the fact I forgot to reply? Red's actually my favourite colour.
Not red the colour, but red as in the past of read.
Ah, got you. Sorry, I didn't mean to leave you on red. It's just I was in the middle of something and then I got distracted and then...
Okay, Roy, I understand. What was so important that you couldn't reply?
I was eating a really nice banana, and then I just forgot. Sorry.
That's a terrible excuse. It's a good thing we're friends, or I might think you were ignoring me. Anyway, let's listen to these examples.
I can't believe I was left on red. I sent him a message, and I can see he's looked at it, but he hasn't replied.
My partner always leaves me on red. They get really distracted and then don't message me back.
You shouldn't assume the worst if you get left on red. If someone reads your message and doesn't reply, they might be really busy and planning to respond later.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're talking about the expression left on red. We use this when someone has read a message but hasn't replied. So, were you really eating a banana and that's why you left me on red?
Yeah, sorry. Well,
I was also playing video games, which might have been the main reason.
Ha, I knew it. Well, the next time I want to offer you free tickets to the Rob's Rolling Biscuits rock concert. Hopefully you'll reply and not just leave me on read.
What? Free tickets? Let me read the message again. Can I still have the tickets?
Sorry, it's too late now. I gave them to Neil. He didn't leave me on read. Bye, Roy.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Feifei.
And I'm Neil.
And Neil, we have a musical expression. Do you like rock music?
Rock? Yeah, I love it.
Really?
Yeah, when I was younger, I was in a rock band. We had it all. Long hair, loud guitars, even louder drums, leather, all that jazz.
Jazz? Hang on. Was it a jazz or a rock band?
Very funny. All that jazz is our phrase, and it has nothing to do with jazz.
Indeed. It simply means and so on, or and other similar things.
You often use it after listing things. For example, I love Christmas dinner. You've got turkey, Brussels sprouts, roast potatoes, gravy, all that jazz. It's just great.
You're not wrong. I love all that jazz too. And now you've made my mouth water. So let's take a break and listen to these examples.
I had a super lazy weekend. I woke up late, got some coffee, went for a walk, watched a couple of movies, all that jazz. It was great.
I don't read celebrity gossip. You know, who's going out with who got plastic surgery, all that jazz. I'm just not interested.
It's often used in a list of unpleasant or boring things.
For example, this morning I cleaned the whole house. Washing, scrubbing, vacuuming, all that jazz.
Yes, by using jazz to describe dull things, it's ironic and brings some humour.
It does, Feifei, especially when we compare it with the phrase to jazz up. You can jazz up an outfit or jazz up a meal, for example, which means to make something more interesting and even glamorous.
Before we go, we should of course mention the phrase is also the name of a song from the 1975 Broadway musical Chicago. Fancy singing it for us, Neil?
Oh, well, I really couldn't. After all, I was in a rock band, not a jazz band. What about you, Feifei?
Maybe next time. I can't remember the words.
Excuses, excuses. Bye for now.
Bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Neil.
Hello, I'm Feifei. All well, Neil?
Not great, Feifei.
What's up?
I'm just so done with writing this report.
You're done with it? You've finished?
I wish. The opposite. Lots more to do.
So you're not done yet?
No, sadly. If you say you're so done with something, it means you're irritated and bored by it. It's often a task that you don't want to do.
Indeed. For example, I could say, I'm so done with recording with Neil.
Well, you could say it, Feifei, but it wouldn't be true.
Of course it's not true. Let's hear some examples.
Oh, I need a new job. I'm so done with delivering pizza.
I need to get to bed earlier. I'm so done with feeling like a zombie every day.
I'm so done with learning Hungarian. The grammar is so hard.
So, Neil, do you need some help with the report?
Ah, that's kind. I just need to sit down, focus and write the thing. It's just boring.
If you like, we can swap. I'm making an incredibly dull spreadsheet right now.
Wow, sounds great.
I'm so done with it.
Tell you what, let's work hard all afternoon and then treat ourselves to dinner.
Done. Which means, of course, that I agree to your suggestion.
Perfect. Bye for now.
See you later.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. I'm Neil and joining me in this programme is Feifei.
Hi.
Beautiful day today, isn't it? Blazing sunshine. Oh, it's so warm.
Yes, it is. And luckily for you, your shift is finished after this programme, isn't it?
Yep. But you have to stay here till evening on the late shift. Ah, I'm off to the park to enjoy the sun. I'd better buy some sun cream, hey?
Don't rub it in.
Ah, okay. See you later.
2 hours later.
My word, Neil, what's happened to you? You look like a lobster.
It's very hot and sunny out there.
But what about the sun cream?
You told me not to rub it in, Feifei.
Okay, I think I need to explain something. We use the expression to rub something in when a person keeps mentioning something another person wants to forget. When I said, don't rub it in, I was fed up of hearing about your wonderful afternoon in the sun while I'm stuck here in the office.
Ah, so I actually should have rubbed in this sun cream. Let's hear some examples.
Don't rub it in. I know you beat me at tennis, but you don't have to keep mentioning the score.
Carlos got into Oxford, but I didn't. That's bad enough, but he keeps rubbing it in by talking about it all the time.
This is the English we speak, and in this programme we're learning the phrase to rub it in. If a person rubs it in, it means they keep mentioning something another person wants to forget.
I want to forget that I've got such a terrible sunburn.
Well, I won't rub it in and talk about that sun cream you should have...
Should have rubbed in. Thanks, Feifei. Ouch.
Bye.
Bye.
The English we speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello and welcome to The English We Speak. With me, Feifei.
And me, Roy.
In this programme, we have an expression to describe when someone is very tired and has used all their energy. It can also be used for things when they're out of battery or fuel. Speaking of which, Roy, you look exhausted.
Thanks, Feifei. Do I look that bad? I do feel tired, though.
Roy, you look like you're running on fumes.
You mean my car has run out of petrol? I usually say my car is running on fumes when the fuel needle shows empty, but somehow the car keeps going.
Yes, the phrase running on fumes does relate to cars, but we also use it to talk about people. You look like you have no energy, so you are running on fumes.
I suppose I am. It must be all the hard work I'm doing to help people learn English.
Hard work? I saw you sleeping at your desk the other day.
Exactly. I was so tired and running on fumes that I fell asleep.
Anyway, let's listen to these examples.
He's been working so hard at work recently, he's running on fumes. I'm worried about him.
Towards the end of the match, the footballer said she was running on fumes.
I was running on fumes yesterday. I couldn't concentrate in the meeting.
This is the English we speak from BBC Learning English. We're talking about the expression running on fumes, which describes a situation where you have no energy but you keep going. So, why else are you so tired?
Well, I have a baby and he cries a lot. I spend all night looking after him, so I have no energy.
That makes sense. Why didn't you call me to say you'd be in work later?
Well, my phone was running out of battery. It was running on fumes.
Sounds like everything in your life is running on fumes. You, your car, your phone.
True, but I'm really impressed you compared me with a car earlier. If I were a car, I'd probably be a really expensive sports car.
Roy, if you were a car, you'd probably wouldn't even have four wheels. Bye.
Bye.
The English we speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Hello, I'm Feifei and welcome to The English We Speak.
And hello, I'm Rob.
You're looking pleased with yourself, Rob.
Oh, I am. I've just booked these dirt cheap, I mean really cheap, flights to Ibiza.
Wonderful.
Look at the price. £20 return. That means extra money to spend on food, drink and partying.
Oh, let's have a look. Hold on. The basic price is £20. But look at the tax you have to pay on top. £100.
Let me see. You're right. Ugh, I hate paying tax.
I guess you could say it's a necessary evil.
You could say that.
If you mean it's something bad that can't be avoided and you have to accept it in order to achieve a good result.
That's exactly what I meant, Rob. If it can't be avoided, like paying tax on a plane ticket, then it's a necessary evil. Let's hear some examples, shall we?
For me, exams are a necessary evil. You have to do them to get a place at university.
Sitting in traffic for hours is a necessary evil if I want to drive to the seaside on a public holiday.
Oh, I hate running, but having to exercise is a necessary evil if I want to stay fit and healthy.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're finding out about the phrase a necessary evil. It describes something that you have to accept in order to achieve something else. And Rob, that tax on your plane ticket is unavoidable, so not so cheap now, is it?
No, less money for eating, drinking and partying.
Can you get a refund? Stay at home and eat, drink and party?
I could, but if I stayed at home, there's another necessary evil I have to deal with.
What's that?
I'll have to spend more time with you.
What time is your flight exactly?
What, did I say something wrong?
Bye.
Bye-bye.
The English We Speak.
From BBC Learning English.
Welcome to The English We Speak. It's Feifei here with Rob, and we're in a bit of a rush.
Yes, yes, I've hurt my foot, and we've got to get to hospital. Ouch!
Ooh, it looks nasty, Rob. All red and swollen. It was a good job I was driving by when you hurt it.
Yes, yes, thanks for the lift, Feifei, but it really is hurting, so could you step on it, please?
What?
Step on it.
Oh, okay, if you say so.
Ow! Oh, that was painful. What did you do that for?
You said step on it. I thought that was an odd request, but I did.
No, Feifei, I meant drive faster. That's what step on it means. It's what you say to someone to ask them to hurry. Oh, that hurt so much.
Oops, sorry. Right, well, hold on tight, Rob. I will step on it while we hear some examples.
Taxi! Could you take me to the station, please? Could you step on it? I'm late.
Our coach told us to step on it if we wanted to get to the match on time.
Please, step on it. Otherwise, we're going to miss the plane.
This is The English We Speak from BBC Learning English, and we're finding out about the phrase step on it, which means go faster or hurry up. Well, we're nearly at the hospital, Rob.
Good, good, because my foot hurts so much, I need urgent medical attention.
How exactly did you hurt it?
Well, I was playing football and another player stepped on my big toe. Oh, it was so painful.
What? So you've got me to step on it and drive at high speed because someone stepped on your big toe? This isn't an emergency, Rob. You can get out and walk.
That's not very nice.
You had better step on it, Rob. The casualty department shuts in 5 minutes. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed it. We have many more exciting videos to help you improve your English. So be sure to subscribe to our channel to get the full experience of our YouTube channel. See you there.